So as you can see, the title doesn't lie. It's a blast. I really love this movie, and it really epitomizes that experience of seeing something you've never seen before, and then also thinking as you're experiencing that, how the hell did they do that? And that's just a small sample of it. So we're gonna dig into a lot of those things with the people responsible for that movie tonight, starting with the producer, Kyle Martin. We also have the lead animator, Jane Samborski. And finally, writer-director Dash Shaw. So let's start with the obvious, Dash. This is your first feature as a writer-director, but you have a background in comic books. So explain the transition, the decision to make an animated feature and how you made that leap.
I always liked a particular kind of animation that comes from comics. Like I call it limited animation. Like an example is the Astro Boy. So there, like Tezuka was a comic artist and he wanted to compete with Disney, but the Japanese television companies didn't give him that much money. So he invented a kind of a way of making animation while limiting the drawings, because he didn't have the budget to do like a full squash and stretch style cartoon. And that I thought there was something like a particular beauty to that limited form. Like the Charlie Brown Christmas special is another example where it originates in comics and then it's a comic, or it's an animated version of this comic. But you don't have to know, I don't think you have to know about the comic to appreciate it as cinema. And so I had done a comic short story that had this title, and it was like 7 pages long. And the original spark of that story was that when I was a teenager, there were two kind of schools of comics. There was the alternative autobio, most 99% autobio comics, like Chester Brown and Seth and all these people after Crumb. And then there was like the mainstream boys' adventure stories. And so the joke premise of this comic was to have a character with my name, but he's clearly delusional and living through like this boys' adventure fantasy comic. So then when I thought, I want to participate in this limited animation world, or kind of like branch off the animation tree, I saw that short story could do, if I brought it over into animation, it could do a lot of interesting things, that it could do, that it kind of related to Hollywood movies or disaster, like explosion movies, but also like DIY independent cinema and how it's drawn and looks, and also kind of like experimental cinema and its color. So it wasn't just to make a movie, it was like I really wanted to participate in a very kind of specific kind of animation.
And so Jane, you're lead animator on the film, but you're also Dash's wife, so obviously you were pretty close to him during this transition, as it were. Was he being completely pretentious, assuming that he could make that jump into the animation field, or what did you make of sort of the steps involved in getting there?
That is an excellent question. I would say that there was never any pretension there. Dash went into it very cautiously. I think he knew that there were things that he could do and could not do, and part of the reason that this story was chosen was because there is a lot of just dialogue between characters, and he says, yes, I can do that. I can do close-ups with facial expressions and write funny dialogue, and he's a wonderful director in that he brought in, where he wasn't sure how to do things, he brought in other artists who had experience with those things.
It seemed like the most doable story.
Which I think it's interesting to note that this came out of sort of the frustration of ruined cast, sort of, where like Dash and Jane were trying to get a different film made, that, and I think you got to the point where it was just like, forget trying to get big name actors to sign on board to get the budget to greenlight the thing. Like, we can just go in our kitchen and draw the movie.
Yeah, like when you said, like, enter the animation field, it was kind of, I don't think we ever thought we were entering the animation field. It was more like, can we draw this thing? Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
you know?
Let's just start.
There was no, you know, it didn't go through a studio or anything.
Right, so how many artists were involved ultimately in the finished product?
I would say that most of the present time animation is just Dash and I, and then there's maybe five or six other artists doing backgrounds or flashback sequences.
Yeah, a little, like everything that you saw up there just now was Jane and I, and Curtis did the liquid light effects.
That were in that very last shot, yeah.
So liquid light effects, that's a term some people may understand more than others, but it's one of many different things you were throwing around here. The way that you talk about it is this very organic process of you just start making the thing in your kitchen, but let's get into some of the specifics there. I mean, what did you use really to layer the different facets of the animation here? Because even though that one scene looks that one way, there are other scenes of the movie that look completely different, you know, watercolor paintings of all different sorts and things like that.
Well, we're working with the program After Effects, which is a wonderfully powerful program. And it was always our goal to try and maintain as much as possible, to do things that we could do in traditional, like, 2D film camera animation. So, like, while we are doing multiplane and using the 3D engine within After Effects, we really made a major effort to keep it in the 2D space.
You said there's a lot of different looks in the movie, and that's true, but it's all like, it would just be a different painting scanned in.
Yeah, you know, every single piece is a physical object made by an artist that exists in the real world. There's virtually nothing in the film that's purely digital.
The goal was to replicate traditional animation just using a scanner instead of a multi-plane Disney camera. You know, it was compiled in, but those liquid light effects, like, those come from things that I would see in, like, Ralph Bakshi movies or 60s, 70s kind of stonery animated movies.
So you're saying the conventional Disney camera, for those who don't know, is like this giant thing looking down on a frame, and what you were doing was just taking those frames and putting them in a scanner one after another.
Foreground, background layer.
So
there would be elements that you would hand draw and then paint or color in, right? And then that stuff would get scanned and then moved around digitally, right? Is that?
Yeah, that is correct.
So there's no line. I mean, yeah.
Was your kitchen just completely covered in watercolor paintings for a couple years there?
It would have days where it was like that, but then I would put them all away. I'm a little...
How long did the overall animation process take, would you say?
I think we were doing drawings and paintings for a little over 3 years.
Which is significantly longer than the traditional indie narrative tends to shoot, which is an understatement.
The script was written in 2010, and then it was like boarded in like 2011. Then we had maybe 70% of the movie drawn before the actors came on in like 2014. And then it was in a
6-year journey. But Kyle, to bring you more into this, why don't you talk a little bit about when you entered that process, and coming from a more kind of traditional producer background, you know, what were some of the challenges of getting the right people on board this project and making it clear what these guys were working on?
Well, I came on board around that 2014 time where, you know, I got an email from Dash, and he's like, hey, I have this movie. It's about 80, 75% drawn. I just need to find some actors to do the voices so we can make the mouths move, and then we'll be done. And so, which was incredibly exciting to me, because that seemed like the easy part. And in many ways, like, my job as a producer was very simple. Like, they had done all of the legwork. They had made the movie and getting actors to stand in front of a microphone in a studio is like super, that's fairly easy. That's an easy like production thing.
So there was a rough cut of this movie with what, just your voices in it? Or what did it look like before the actors got involved?
It wasn't really assembled. I mean, they had, you had the scenes drawn and sort of scanned and maybe assembled scene by scene.
I had made a demo too we had put together that didn't have voices in it.
It did have voices. There was there was like a teaser reel that we showed actors.
I tried to hide. There was no.
The world's not supposed to know about that one.
Well, no, I tried to pick little, like someone says,
salt water or something, you know.
Oh, yeah, salt water. The composer said something. But yeah, we didn't have it. I didn't know how to record anything.
Yeah. But anyway, it was fairly easy because Dash. That is also a very well-known and sort of successful comic book graphic novel writer, and so, and has fans and is known in that world. Semi-successful or whatever, you know, relatively successful. So it was, so we had this movie that was, Dash had this movie that was virtually completed. He had a really funny script that was just like, it was just so easy to read and fun to read, and had this kind of like teasery thing that we could show people, and had fans out in the sort of industry. So, like Jason Schwartzman and Lena Dunham like knew Dash's work, and we all had relationships with them from previous projects, and so that was just like a semi easy kind of call, like, hey, we're doing this thing. Do you want to be involved? And it was a bit of an easy ask. It's like, we need you for an hour in a recording studio. It wasn't like, we need you for 6 weeks. We need to block out your schedule. And they were game. They were super game. They just like wanted to. I mean, they dug Dash, and they knew the sense of humor. And
so, even for somebody like Jason Schwartzman, who's voicing the lead character, it was really just an hour of voice work for the whole movie.
He was more. I mean, but it wasn't a lot.
It was like 18 hours cumulatively.
Right. Because usually, when you hear about studio, I mean, it's like at least, you know, they're putting in a couple weeks. You know.
Yeah, so. I don't know what they're doing. Or I mean. We would have days that would kind of, we'd go through this script many times, and then we would have like other characters in the script, like, oh, Reggie, you want to play the newscaster? Okay. You know, he'd just do a bunch of different characters.
And then would you have to go back and sort of rejiggle things in the animation to make those kind of changes?
Yeah, everything, I mean, and they would come up with their own things, of course, and then we'd redraw things and put it into the movie.
And to say that we had it 70% done before the actors, there were no mouths moving and there were no facial expressions changing. So all of that is influenced by the wonderful work that we got from our cast.
And what were some of the challenges of working with these different artists? I mean, it's one thing to kind of have your own specific vision for this, but to bring people in who have their own aesthetic, their own way of working, their own pace, I mean, how did you sort of coordinate with them to make sure you were getting what you needed at the end of the day?
Yeah, something that I really liked about Ralph Bakshi movies is that I could tell that he cast the artists like he cast actors, where he knew kind of what Mike Plug drew like, and so we'll have him draw the flashback sequence in Wizards, and it'll look different than the rest of the movie, but it'll be like, it then becomes part of the aesthetic of the movie, you know? And as opposed to like hiring, like having a style guide and then hiring a bunch of people to try to draw like style guide. And the Bakshi method, in my mind, is more respectful of these people as individual artists, and then also it's going to be a collaborative process anyway, so why not like hire, you know, have someone do what they like to do or what you feel their skills are being applied to a specific part. So like I knew one example is Frank Santoro is a great kind of unusual comic artist, and he was a landscape painter, and I always thought it would be super cool to see a painting that by him in an animated movie, because no animated movie would have a painting like that in it. So I'll ask him to do the exterior, the main kind of exterior, the ocean waves and specific things. So it was all like that, like try to cast these people I knew their work from alternative comics to incorporate them into the movie.
Sort of a curator in a way.
Yeah, and then the movie becomes that becomes the look of the movie, is these the collage-like look.
Yeah, it's very interesting also because, I mean, you mentioned Ralph Bakshi, and one of the things that I think about when I see those movies is that they don't make it easy for you at first, and you sort of, with time, you get used to the look of the movie and the world that they're building up, and I got that sense with this one too. I mean, the movie opens with a seizure warning, but it's also got characters who, you know, move with jiggly lines. You're not trying to make everything, you know, easy to look at first, but then, you know, with time, you kind of just get used to it. So how much of that were you guys talking about? You know, how people were going to watch this, how to keep up a certain consistency with that world?
I think that was really just things that I liked. Like, I mean, the seizure warning, it's true, there's a lot of, like, dizzying effects in the movie, and so it's real. But it's also, there's a famous Pokemon episode that, and so I thought that was like a dangerous cartoon, you know? And I thought that it would make sense to put it in here.
So nobody made you put that there. This was more.
Well, we kind of talked about it. I was pushing for it though.
Yeah.
More than anyone else. Yeah. And then when we had Mickey Duje, who does a lot of the titles are hand lettered because he's trained as a sign painter.
Like that warning, it's all handmade. It's not like a font.
People look at it and think it's done on the computer, but he's really trained as a sign painter, and he knew how to do it. And so once he drew it, then I thought we have to use it because he'd worked so hard figuring out how to write warning, you know. I always liked it when the cartoon messed up cartoons, like the in a comic, because it's like Frozen. There's the differences between the characters kind of really stand out. Like you notice when a drawing is off model. But in animation, the drawings are flying past you in time. And so when things are off model, I thought it added a real genuine energy to it. Like there's a cartoon called Fist of the North Star. And it came from trying to interpret illustrative drawing into animation, you know? Like, another example would be like the first Johnny Quest episode. So they drew in a hatchy illustrative style, which is difficult to translate into drawing into animation, because you have to draw it a million times. So when someone would move their arm, there would be flickering lines of different ways of hatching a muscle. And when I saw that as a kid, I thought it was the coolest. Because I understand what's happening in the scene, that this guy is punching this other guy, but there was also this other abstract story. There's the literal story of what's happening, and then also like the story of abstract lines and changing shapes and color. So maybe what it could be considered abrasiveness is something I thought was exciting, and I liked it, and was shooting for it. I mean, I really go out of my way in this movie to people's facial expressions flicker out. Cheap cartoon, messed up cartoons.
Yeah, I think it also is true of the colors. Dash does all of the black and white line drawings in the film, but I'm responsible for a lot of like the crazy color sequences, and it's just it is abrasive, but it's also like invigorating to see something that just out there, and we wanted to take those risks.
I think it comes to what you like. So I saw a shorts program at a different festival, and I was surprised how all the shorts looked very like professionally shot. You know, they all looked like they had like real professional DPs, like they were trying to get gigs in like real movies. And I thought this is like the place to show like some other thing.
So you revel in sort of the imperfectionism in a certain way. I've heard other animators talk this way, Bill Plimpton and Don Hertzfeld, people who really do spend their time kind of working with their own resources. So it does seem consistent with that approach. You know, when you
I was kind of disappointed in that program. I thought this would be the one place to see like some messed up thing, and I didn't get to see it. It looked like it was tryouts for what everything else looks like.
Well, I mean, it's also kind of amusing because on some level, you know, it's great to hear you talk about that kind of freedom. On the other hand, it creates a certain kind of practical challenge because we never know what's going to come out of that laboratory approach. So, Kyle, were there ever moments where, as a producer, you had to do that kind of come back to reality talk and say, hey, we can't do this crazy thing? Or
No way. I mean, I think we were all on board. I mean, I think everyone that was working on the film, a big part of that was because there was that sort of gonzo element to what Dash and his sensibility was all about. Like, we wanted kind of more of that in a way. Just like, in fact, like the beginning is actually, I think, the part of the movie that you guys worked the most on, because it seemed very early on, like when we were showing rough cuts and works in progress, it was hard to kind of nail the tone at the beginning, or at least like let people know right away what kind of movie it was, because there's different mediums, there's paint, there's crayon, there's colored pencil, there's ink, and so it took a long time to just kind of get that sequence right, like up until the kids actually go in the school. For anybody who's seen it, there's like that whole bus ride kind of sequence with the credits and everything, and it felt like that was actually like a tricky thing. That was the hardest thing to nail, where it was really a little bit more like, maybe we have to like throw in a joke just to let people know that there's like a subversive kind of tonal thing going on here. There's some scary stuff we might have to sprinkle in a little bit.
At least so they don't,
it's an animated movie about high school children, but it's not a children's movie. And there was definitely a way to begin the movie that could have been like wrong, or sort of sent the wrong message about who the audience was, or like what was going to happen at the end of the ride. And I think that was, I don't know, I feel like if anything, that was like the part where most of our notes were about, is just really about like
setting up for the craziness,
just kind of planting some seeds about like what the tone and the aesthetic was going to be like, which is to say, which was a broad spectrum, which was like just like make sure people know that there's a lot of kind of crazy stuff that might happen, and it's supposed to be fun and playful and like enjoyable and silly.
How much did you guys keep tweaking that? I mean, were you closing your eyes to go to bed at night and seeing different images from the movie and having the inspiration to update different kinds of scenes? I mean, it seems like there's such a loose approach that you really could kind of be inventive in that respect.
Absolutely. We were making changes and adding things and revising all the way up until the last possible minute. Some of the last things that went in, Kyle talked about revising that beginning segment. For those of you who have seen the film, the locker room scene with the ghosts was a very late addition. Because we wanted to bring in some of the more mixed media pieces into the early part of the film. And some of the psychedelic sequences near the end, both with Dash drowning and with the flowers, are also very late revisions to find those final images.
It was definitely the thing. I mean, I feel like if we didn't have a deadline, you would have perpetually kept drawing and painting. Right? I mean, it was just like, it would have gone on endlessly until someone said, okay, we have to show the movie now, Dash.
So what was that deadline?
Toronto.
Oh, Jane's child.
That's a pretty key deadline.
Jane put her foot down. There's no more.
So when you were finally done with the movie and you started sending it out to people, did you feel pretty confident about what you made? Or, I mean, did you have a sense for how people were going to react to it, given that it's, you know, so hard to describe to people exactly what it's like to watch this thing?
I think the reaction has been kind of beyond our wildest dreams. It's been absolutely wonderful.
You got to give me more than that. I mean, what did you expect when you were working on this project in terms of what people were going to see?
I had no idea. For me, I needed to stay very close to the project. It's such a huge undertaking that I chose to try not to watch it in its entirety any more than I had to. And to stay very close, so like I just didn't get overwhelmed. And you work on something for that long, it's just, it's very easy. You don't even know if it's good anymore sometimes. And I'm very lucky to have a team that was so completely believed in the film. Because we were all kind of keeping each other moving throughout the process?
It was a long thing, you know, and so there were different stages, like Kyle will produce it, like, okay, great.
It must be
and
good.
And then then when the cast came, then for me it was like, oh, other people might see this movie, you know. And then that was like, well, guess we'll just keep making the same thing, you know. And then it's cool to see it play at a theater. I never thought it would really play on a theater screen. It was more focused on like, can we actually like make it? Than any expectation past that.
Yeah, there really were conversations sitting at the kitchen table, being like, you know, this might never see the light of day. Like, we might release this on the internet for like 50 cents a copy if we're lucky.
Were there any crazy disaster moments, you know, noticing something you scanned was torn in two or something like that?
About a year into the process, we lost, through just like a copy-paste error, like, I don't know. Like 15 minutes of it. It was kind of devastating.
But it all existed as, but you know, that'll show you, that's a good example of why very little was done on the computer, because it was lost, but we still had all of the elements.
The original plans, and so it was just rebuilt.
It was very easy to rebuild it.
Yeah.
That was the thing that pops into my head, not really as a mistake, but there's a lot of cat hairs in the movie, because
that's what I was gonna
we
talk
had
about
cat,
because nobody
the
was indexing
bed.
The scanner.
It's awesome. It's my favorite part about the movie. Which is, that's like one of the great things about my experience with this process was that there was so much that like, they just rolled with the punches. And it's like, there's cat hairs on that image you just scanned. And they're, I don't know. Next scene. I don't know.
You got to freeze the movie to really see it.
You don't really
it.
Even
no.
have to.
No.
Yeah.
There's a lot of the background paintings.
Like at sometimes I was like, but oh, that must be like a paintbrush, like you know, a piece of hair from the paintbrush. I was like, no.
But
I
you thought it was
cats.
Like, oh, it's like there's a hair in the gate or whatever.
Yeah, right. If that was like a live action film, it would have been digitally removed. But it just became the sort of.
I mean,
I
we
know.
Did digitally remove a lot of cat hairs. Oh. A lot of stuff, but I mean,
we weren't sweating the small things, like, but that was part of the fun of it. I think.
It was, yeah. It was only when it was like super distracting.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, what audience do you see for a movie like this? I mean, you must have been thinking about certain kinds of things. People have thrown around names like John Hughes when they refer to it, but they also talk about, you know, Adult Swim animation, and there are audiences for those kinds of things, but they're usually different audiences.
I wonder about that. Like part of me is like, oh, this movie's for like 15-year-old nerds who are into drawing and painting, and maybe it is for them, but we didn't really try to find a bunch of those people and like screen it for them and ask them what they thought about it. And then I wonder, well, it was made, maybe it was just made for myself, like I wanted to make it, but then it was too much work to do, it was not a lot of fun, you know, to do a lot of these drawings, and like there must have been something really that I really wanted to participate in, and I think it was made for it to be a contribution to that kind of limited animation branch. But people, Kyle would say everyone would like this movie, right?
That's why I still think that. Like, I don't know, I mean, I think of it as like, and we talk about this, is like, I just think of it as a really fun indie comedy or something. I mean, it happens to be animated, but, I mean, this is the kind of thing for me, it's like, if this was out in theaters, I don't think there'd be anything else like it, you know, that you could go see that weekend. And that for me is super exciting. Like those are the kinds of movies I see, is the sort of the thing that sticks out, whatever that might be. And I don't know.
I mean, John Hughes, I know, but I didn't think of the, you know, I never thought about him really when I was working. I don't remember thinking about him. And like the Adult Swim world, in my mind, the humor is there's a sweetness in this movie that I don't think I associate with Adult Swim. And there's also kind of a more formal like aspect to it, the color and like, so I didn't, there definitely wasn't like I didn't think it would fit into any particular slot like that.
But that also wasn't like a motivating factor. I mean, we weren't making decisions based on, oh, what's the audience? The audience we're making this for won't dig this, so we can't do that. It was more of just like, it was very intuitive for what I think Dash and Jane just felt.
Try to finish, and just to have fun,
I think, was.
Yeah.
Better to do something people have never seen before than trying to replicate something else, obviously. Although, having looked at your earlier work in the comics, it does feel like a natural outgrowth. I mean, a lot of your comics are, you've experimented with tone and you've done more serious stories, kind of sillier stories, but there's a certain consistency. And one of the things I'm curious about is what you're seeing is difference between those two worlds. I mean, they're kind of like two different subcultures and two different, you know, creative processes. So.
The mediums or the industries, or you both?
Yeah, let's start with the kind of the industry side of it.
Well, the first thing that pops into my head is that the comics, my section, whatever part I'm in the comics industry is very small. There's comics is small, and then a lot of people will call art comics is even smaller. And then a lot of people don't know what a good comic is. And maybe you'd have to grow up reading them, and then like, I don't think very many people can see that like Roy Crane by Buzz Sawyer is like a masterpiece, you know? But in movies, every single person thinks they know their opinion is the right one with movies. And average person on the street will be like, that movie sucked. That movie was great. You know, everyone's very confident in their opinion of movies, where in comics, especially unusual comics, I think people don't read them or don't know what to think about them, you know, how they feel about them. You know, there was a TIFF screening of a press and industry screening of High School Sinking, and Kyle told me 90 people went to it. And I thought, oh my God, 90 people saw this movie on a screen? And it was like, I couldn't find nine people who would like be really interested enough to write about an art comic. You know, it's a very small, and I always thought that I think those unusual comics really have something special to offer, but you'd have to have an unusual life path to maybe be to tune into them, you know. That's, I think, a big industry difference.
Jane, anything you want to add to that?
My knowledge of the comic industry is really like one step removed, watching Dash do industry things. And what I just would reiterate is how small it is. I mean, you go to one comic convention and you meet everyone that's there, and the second one has the same population.
Same person talking to you.
Yep. it's very, very small. And so it's very close-knit, and everybody's like working with each other. And I think that does breed a respect that has come over into Dash's, the way
there
he
is
brought his artists.
There is something that if you're a super, you know, there are cartoonists that are working at a very high level that are, and it's all completely self-motivated, really. And there is something cool about being completely devoted to this medium that has a very small readership, but knowing that you're like at the top of that medium. You know what I mean? Like that other people, you have to be a little, there's a reason why a lot of comic artists are crazy people. You know, a sane person would drop out at a certain point, you know? That's really true. I've met a lot of the great cartoonists, and there's always something off with them.
I do think if you had not come from comics, which is not an industry that makes a lot of money, that you have to be, I need to make this thing, so I'm going to make this thing. I don't know if you would have dived in to make High School Sinking without financing. I think a lot of people
maybe would have assumed that. Or just to illustrate that point, it's like the irony, and I don't, but it, like, sort of what you've been living off of the past couple of years is the options, movie TV options of your previous comic books, which haven't even been made yet.
Yeah.
So the comic book's value in the other, in the film industry, even though they haven't even materialized into anything, is still overwhelmingly greater than what they are in their own or industry in their original form. And that's the sort of weird irony.
David Goyer, the Batman versus Superman writer, he optioned Doctors, which is a book I did, which is... That's someone laughing.
Is that Amy?
Yes.
She can't get over that one.
You know, which is like a kind of semi-experimental book, you know? So, and that money basically went to us making High School Sinking.
Yeah.
So your Batman versus Superman money paid for this movie. Thank you for seeing it. Should I keep answering the medium question? Comics, I feel like are about like simultaneity and juxtaposition and still pictures, and they're collage like. And movies, I feel like when I started making this, I thought were a visual medium. Like I'd heard someone say that at some point, and I thought it was true. And so I thought that visuals could carry more of a movie when I started this than when I was working on it. I realized that like a music video can look super cool, but then you'll be bored 30 seconds in. And I think there's something that it's like a control of time, that time is more important in movies maybe, or order of events, that the visuals won't carry it so far. That was something, and obviously books don't have time. The reader controls the time.
Right. It's interesting to bring that up too, just in terms of, you know, where your preferences are. And before we take a couple questions from the audience, I wanted to ask you about, you know, where you see your priorities at this point. I mean, certainly there are examples of people who have worked in graphic novels and found their way into the filmmaking side of things. Dan Clowes has been writing screenplays and things like that, but still primarily identifies as a cartoonist. Where would you say you find yourself at this point? I mean, are you a filmmaker now, or is this still a blurry line?
I'd like to just make another movie that is also in this, that looks different than this movie, but is in the same zone of limited animation. So I think that there's more to do inside of this. So that's my goal, to make I'm working on another graphic novel and another movie.
I do think you will probably continue to make short stories and comics, though. We've talked about how that's it's an integral part of his creative process to like try out new ideas in that, which is a much more forgiving format than a movie, which takes many years to do.
Sounds like a healthy
balance.
Much more.
The immediacy is, I think, very good for Dash as a writer and as an artist.
Seeing results. So let's take some questions from the audience. Just shoot your hand in the air when you have one, and make sure to wait for the microphone when it gets to you. We talked about a lot of stuff, but I'm sure there are some other questions from people out there that we haven't touched on. Anyone? I know it was comprehensive, but there's more. Can you just wait for the microphone, please, because they record it. Sorry. We need waiting music or something.
On the simplest level, where do you live? I mean, do you live in a city, out in the boondocks? I mean, does that influence your state of mind, your wife's state of mind?
We lived in Brooklyn for many years, but then we just left, and now we live in Richmond, Virginia.
I would say, I really loved working in Brooklyn. We were in kind of a confined space. We were both living and working in the same space. And I think that was something that was kind of difficult for Dash to center himself. But I always loved the immediacy of being able to like literally turn around and, or at any hour of the day, be able to say, oh, I finally have come up with a solution for this problem. But, you know, it's, every creative process needs space. So I think that that will be helpful.
I felt like my brain was going to explode living in Brooklyn. Like,
did you make all your books? Was the very first book in New York? Everything was in New York.
No.
No? Bottomless belly button was...
I think I drew that in Richmond before. And I think the crowd started bothering me in New York. I couldn't afford to have enough space. I had a fellowship at the New York Public Library for a year, and that helped me. I got to get up and go. It helped me because I had my own office, my own space. But then I was commuting to Midtown, you know, at 9 a.m. and leaving at 6 p.m. with the masses. And it painted a horrible picture of humanity doing that for a year.
It sounds like you got your creative juices flowing one level or another.
I thought I have to, at the end of it, I was like, I have to get out of this place. Yeah. I like New York. I don't know. There's a lot of things I like about New York, but.
You may as well acknowledge also that you went to school in the city, yeah. School of Visual Arts. You want to maybe give us a little bit of background about how that sort of set you on this path, because I think it has some connection to the movie being here, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah, at SVA, I was a cartooning major, and so I met a lot of people who are like my favorite artists, like Gary Panter and David Mazzucchelli, James McMullen, and I also worked at the SVA Film Library. And so I was in charge of getting the films to different classes. And so I was I would watch a lot of movies, and I took some film classes, and I also took Amy Taubin's class. And she was a programmer here, and so I really liked her class, and I got a lot out of SVA.
What was that class?
I think the class I took was Women in Film.
Is that right, Amy?
Yeah, you didn't take the experimental class.
I didn't take the experimental class.
It's not too late. You can take some more questions from the crowd. Yeah, over here.
I was wondering, are you approaching the next film project the same way that you did this other project? And also, if you could talk about working with the actors?
Oh, yeah. The next one, I'm trying to do it in a similar way. I have some like formal goals, or I have a script, and now I'm storyboarding it. And one of the goals is to try to record the actors before I really start drawing the movie, and use more of maybe the way the actors look in the movie. And so, I still want to have an animatic of the movie. So one goal is to make an animatic before I go to actors.
But not just record audio, you visually film them, right?
Yes, yes.
As a visual reference, not just the audio.
Before,
which would be a major
difference. This movie, there was, we didn't record the actors like with a camera. It was just their voices, it was just sound. Another one is, so much of this movie is the black line wobbling. And I want the next one to be more like painted pieces. There's a Boy Scout flashback sequence in this movie, and I think that it would be cool if it was just all, it to not have that black line. And it suits this story, the next story, better, which the next story is about a zoo of mythological creatures. So I want it to be like painted kind of, these painted creatures, and more maybe like stop motion animation, in that we're turning the wings of a griffin or something is like unfolding in its separate pieces. I'm trying to kind of just build on skills, or hopefully get better at things that were on this movie, and working with the actors. Yeah. How did I work with the actors? Maybe.
What's that the question?
Yeah, what was it like? Because you didn't really have experience working.
It was great. They were recorded. I guess the main thing is they all kind of got the sensibility of the movie. So they're, you know, I'd known a lot of them before. And then this movie has something that's kind of like I associate with comics, in that there's a dissonance between what the people are saying and what we're seeing. And that's, I think, and one of the many things that's being brought over from comics. Like Dan Klaus is a good example, where the words are kind of an interior world, and then the drawings are the exterior world, or Raymond Pettibone is like the what makes those pieces interesting is how the text and picture relate or don't relate, or so it is weird that in this movie this school is sinking and all of these strange things are happening, but the people stay talking about school and writing but that dissonance is kind of a main element of the movie, and it's helped by the fact that they're being recorded in a studio, and like that closet scene that we just saw was Jason Schwartzman, Reggie Watts, and Maya Rudolph. And so one session would be Maya and Reggie, and I would play Jason's parts, and then the next session would be Jason and Reggie, and I'd play Maya's parts, and then we'd collage it together, collage the audio tracks to make the scene. And then like a year later, we would need something and try to get them to grab a microphone and say it and place it where it needed to go. It was really interesting.
So one other thing I wanted to ask you about is your take on the contemporary animation scene in general. Do you watch a lot of new stuff? Do you pay attention to what the studios are doing versus the indie stuff, which is mostly shorts?
I guess I don't pay that much attention to it. In my mind, the exciting things are happening in alternative comics. And I really love that world and what is happening there. You know, the animations that I like are really, like, I love Susan Pitt's Asparagus. That's from like 1970. I like Fantastic Planet. You know, I've watched those cartoons over and over again. I just like that zone. I don't know. We don't have TV, or we don't watch TV shows.
No pressure to start now, right?
I know everyone says they're the best thing, but you know, you find what you like. I don't know. I find what I like, and I just rather watch Johnny Quest or something.
In between spending 6 years making a movie.
So I get a lot out of the, I really do, I love animation, but it's really like kind of specific animations that I like, and I don't like follow any new animation shows. Yeah.
I mean, I think what we both really respond to is in the older stuff, you still really see the hand, and there's such a push for like the professionalism and most of what's easy to access.
I wouldn't say that, though, because we don't even know. We don't really even watch them. I don't think we should diss them.
Okay. The rumor they're probably has great. They probably are great.
They're probably great. I have a lot of friends who work on Cartoon Network shows, and I see and I like their comics. A lot of great cartoonists work on those shows.
That's true. I do like Adventure Time.
But I don't know. I like watching Astro Boy.
Well, maybe next time when you have you here for your next film, you'll have caught up with a few of their shows and we can revisit that question.
You guys, there's enough people to talk about with TV shows.
We want to get into it now.
Talk to anyone here about a TV show.
I think we have time for maybe one more question, if there's any others. Yep.
I agree about the TV shows, by the way. my question is, with the things that happened by accident, with the cat hairs and things like that. Did you find that you found the beauty in the film in those accidental things, and it makes it a little bit more indie and a little bit more fun, and it's a little bit more niche for you, those audiences that enjoy those funny little quirky things about your film that make it more fun?
I get the correct answer has to be yes.
Yeah. Well, there's a particular kind of happy accident that happens in the film that I've always been fascinated by. Especially when you're taking geometric forms and doing things like spinning them or sliding them, you can create these like really amazing phantom effects. I think the most famous one is called Amoria, where you have like very thin lines and they slide across and you get like a flicker. And that's always been an effect that's just completely fascinated me. And so I was really excited. There's a sequence where there's a halftone pattern that spins, and it creates all of these lines that just aren't there in the original. And I love that so much. And that was something I was really enthusiastic about in the film.
Happy. I think it comes from drawing, you know, like that maybe your hand likes to make a certain kind of mark for whatever reason, and so that ends up being your style. And so you could try to fight that style or try to develop it into something. There's like chemical spills in like Sigmar Polke paintings, you know, that are beautiful, that are like all accident sort of. Liquid light effects are maybe could be, it depends how you would define accident.
Now everybody has to watch the movie and count how many cat hairs they can see in every scene.
That is the game's drinking game.
Thank you for being here, guys. It's a lot of fun.